touch and pin prick.
And this is my knee hammer. What else do I need? And for the time being, I'll do with this. And if I need to do a, I'll use my key to do. You may have to remove your, I may do it on her. Okay, you can come even closer. Paul, can you see from there? You can't see anything. Just stand on top of the chair, no problems. We today we are very democratic. You can stand on top of your table also if you want. Okay, so we'll start the whole system. You'll be asked to do a quick examination. So one I'll demonstrate here, another one I'll demonstrate here, and we'll just keep switching so that you can, all of you can see. Motor system, you have to look for just involuntary movements. Thank God he does not. Oh, I'm sorry. We have to do the basic protocols. I'll just do it once. Hello, my name is Dr. Sanya. I'm your physician for today. You are Mr. Abbott the Badger.
Yes.
So how would you like me to address you?
Mr. the Badger.
And you are... How would you like me to address you? Chanel or Miss Fernandez?
Chanel's fine.
Wonderful. So, okay, I did that only once, but you'll be graded for all these points, okay? So assume you have washed your hands, you have knocked on the door, and you have addressed yourself with your title and your last name. You've asked how you want the patient to be addressed, and they have all confirmed Mr. the Badger and Chanel. Okay, then you start. Motor system, involuntary movements. Just watch. Just watch, the patient is sitting quietly, no involuntary movements, thank God. Look at the bulk of the muscle on corresponding sides. Equal. Bulk of the muscle corresponding sides. Fine. The next one is tone. Please sit down here.
Tone? Oh, I definitely don't have that.
Tone for the upper limb, tone for the lower limb.
Can you sit down here?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's such...
Just keep following there also. For the upper limb, support the elbow. And just passively move the fingers. Passively move the wrist, passively move the elbow, and passively move the shoulder. Remember, I'll be watching you. You should be doing both sides. You lose points because you do only one side and you forget about it. So you have to do the other side also. Support the elbow, passively move the fingers, passively move the wrist, passively. I mean, tell the patient, relax please. Passively move the wrist, elbow, and put the shoulder through a moderate range of movement. Same thing on the leg. For that, you have to go a little back, please. Can you go? You have to go further back.
There's a laptop.
Easy, my laptop.
Oh.
Passively move the knee. It's all shown there. Just look at the pictures. And again to the other side. Passively. You don't do anything? I just do that. Just see whether there's any excess resistance or excess mobility. If there is decreased tone, it'll be like a rag doll. It'll be like a rag doll. Another way to do it is to hold both the wrists up and just let the wrists fall down. See? This is normal. If there is decreased tone, that side wrist will be lower down. And move the joints and see. It's normal. So this is tone. Examination of tone of the upper limb, examination of tone of the lower limb. The next item, next slide, please. Examination of muscle strength. Again. Let's start with the upper limb. Start.
Zero.
You have to do the shoulder, you have to do the elbow, you have to do the wrist, and you have to do the fingers. So shoulder strength, bicep strength, tricep strength, wrist dorsiflexion, grip strength. Then I'm going to demonstrate on the leg. So please extend your hand against my resistance. No, give resistance. This is how you test for shoulder.
I'm weak, sir.
Good, that's fine, that's fine. So you're tested for deltoid. Similarly, again I'm repeating, don't forget to test the opposite side. Many of you do forget and you lose points. Next, I'll ask you to flex your elbow and I'll give resistance. So flex it tightly.
Oh my God. I'm gonna pull off a desk.
Against resistance. Now straighten your hand, try to straighten your hand against resistance. Keep it flexed. Flex it, now try to straighten it. Give resistance. So, biceps, triceps. Next, dorsiflexion of the wrist. Look at the picture very carefully. Next slide. Dorsiflexion should be with the hand closed. Why? Because we don't want them to use the extensor digitorum. So, the wrist should be in the flex position. And so, please make a fist and try to straighten the wrist against resistance. So, this test for dorsiflexion of the wrist. Oh, by the way, Can you just rush down and call the Dr. Gautam also? He's supposed to be here. He's forgotten. So you're supposed to give, ask the patient to make a fist. Move it up. Move it up. And don't let me bring you down. This is dorsiflexion of the wrist. So we will watch you whether you ask the patient to make a fist and whether you are giving resistance. Don't keep it open because otherwise he'll use the extensor digitorum also. So here you're testing for the extensor carpi radialis, longus brevis and ulnaris. Similarly on the other side, please make a fist. Yes, and you try to give resistance. Last one, grip strength. Now watch very carefully. Don't keep your fingers straight next to each other. Why? Sometimes the patient is so strong that they will crush your finger. Always keep one finger over the other finger. We will watch this. Please try to hold my fingers as tightly as you can. You can do both simultaneously. And watch for strength. And with your thumb, just keep holding me. With your thumb, try to remove your finger. This is testing for grip strength. Everybody watch me. Okay, so this is for the upper limb. Now for the lower limb. Now I'm going to use you. You have to go a little back. What is this? I guess. I'm going to tell you this grading, grading just now, sitting there, a few slides earlier, and we'll be asking you that. First, test for adduction, abduction. It's better to do it on him, I mean, I remove him. So, for adduction, keep both your fists slightly separate. Try to bring my hands together. Testing for adduction. Adductors. Okay? Abduction. Try to move my hands out. Abduction. Next, put your hand behind the thigh. Press down on my hand. This is extension of the hip. Gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. This is extension. Flexion. This is, no, iliopsoas. Flexion. You can do both simultaneously. This is the quickest way to do. Next, flexion of the knee. Give resistance. Yes, patient is trying to flex, I'm trying to extend. Do the same on the opposite side. Resistance. Now try to straighten your knee. Straighten it, try to straighten it. Straighten your knee. Yes, give resistance. Straighten. This is extension, so flexion, extension, both sides. Next, try to put your foot up. Give resistance. L5. Try to do only with the great toe. L5. Push down my hand. S1. Just the great toe. S2. So we have tested for all the muscle strength. Grading of muscle strength. Can you go back to slides? You have to know that table. You'll be asked. 0, no tone, no movement at all. 1, breaker. 2, against with gravity eliminated. It's already there in your slide. Gravity eliminated means the gravity is eliminated and the patient is moving like this. Grade 3, against gravity. Grade 4, against gravity and with a little resistance provided by you. And grade 5, normal strength. So you'll be asked the strength. Of course, the subject you'll be having will be normal. Okay, so this is about the motor system. Now next, we have tested for all. Now we come to the cerebellar. It's all here in a simplified form. We have done the motor system. We have done the upper limb. We have done the lower limb. Upper limb, lower limb. Now we are going to test for the cerebellum. Cerebellum basically, is he coming? Oops. Cerebellum basically tests for coordination. So we have four groups of tests. They are headed under four headings. One is called the rapid alternating movement, RAM. I'm going to show you both in the upper limb and the lower limb. Then you have the point-to-point test. Then you have the stance, and then you have the gait. So let's start with the RAM, rapid alternating. Can you do this on one arm? Moderately fast.
Maybe not.
Okay. Can you do it the other way?
So this one's definitely faster than that.
So the absence of this is called dysdynamokinesia. You know that. This is an example of a RAM, rapidly alternating movement test. There's another one for this. You can do it on this also.
Yeah,
this is rapidly alternating movement. It's shown there. There is yet one more way of doing it.
That's weird. Is it the normal side?
There is yet one more way of doing it. Ask the patient to tap his or her thumb with the index finger. It's shown there in that picture, in the lower picture. Ask the patient to tap his or her thumb. So these are the two ramps for the upper limb. Now let's do the ramp for the lower limb. No, you can keep your leg hanging now. Ask the patient to tap your hand with his foot. You can do it simultaneously. Please, no. Tap my, yeah.
Good job, Abhin.
This is the ramp for the leg. Rapid alternating movements. Next one. Next slide, please. Point to point. In the point to point, you do basically the finger nose test. So I'll do one finger nose test with her. Both are very similar. One is to test for dysmetria, the other is to test for pass pointing. Dysmetria, okay? So you have to look at me first. Extend your hand out, your right hand out, with your forefinger. You touch my forefinger, and then you touch your nose. And then touch your nose. Again, touch my forefinger, and bring it out. Bring it out. Do it a few times. No, you have to touch my finger, your nose, again my finger, back.
No!
Back my finger.
His finger.
I'm testing.
Failed the test.
Your other hand, please. So this is the first one. You're moving your finger out, but the patient has got his eyes open.
I'm not good at coordination, sir.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
Oh, you did it wrong.
Josh, shut up!
Touch the finger.
Back my finger. Okay, so this is the finger nose test. You're testing for dysmetria. If the person is persistently overshooting, you're testing for dysmetria. That means when I'm moving, she's overshooting. Now I'll do the other one, which is also very similar. Keep your eyes open first. Do the same thing. Touch your nose. Again, back. My finger, your nose, again my finger, back, again my finger.
That's confusing. Yes. Yeah, yes. See, you're saying it to him.
Okay. Now, close your eyes and do it.
This could be a test of mental function.
Okay, yes. See, this is testing for the other one, pass pointing. So, dysmetria is overshooting. Pass pointing is consistent deviation to one side. Suppose he had a right cerebellar lesion, he would have consistently deviated to the right. So both are very similar. In your exam, we will be testing only the pass pointing, the dysmetria, not the pass pointing. We won't ask the first subject to close his eyes. But these are the two point-to-point tests, dysmetria and pass pointing. Now for the leg. This was with the hand, with the lower limb. I'll use him.
Okay.
It's okay with
sir,
you. Yes.
When you were telling Chanel, you weren't really directing her every time she did it.
Yes, because this was with eyes open. But when you're doing for the pass pointing, you keep the hand in one particular position, ask him to do it a few times with his eyes open, and then ask him to close his eyes and remain, keep your hand in the same position. Because now he's closed his eyes, right? Yeah, because now you're moving, you're keeping his eyes closed, so you have to keep your hand in the same place.
No, I understand that, but do you still instruct him to do each step?
I told him to do it a few times, right?
Yeah.
So he got the habit.
Yeah.
Then I asked him to close his eyes.
Uh-huh.
My finger was still in the same place.
Okay.
In her case, since her eyes were open, I was moving my hand. So in this case, her eyes were already open.
Yeah.
So I was moving my hand to see whether she has got that ability
or
not.
So what's the order then when I'm doing my
You motion? Have to, from here, touch my finger, your nose, again my finger, out.
So,
again
so
touch
so
my finger, your nose,
okay.
This,
okay.
And out.
Okay.
So, and eyes open. After a few eyes open, keep it closed and keep your hand in the same place. Dysmetria, pass pointing. Overshooting, persistent deviation to one side. It's all clearly illustrated. Okay? Now with the leg. With the leg, first you show the patient. This is the simple heel shin test, which all of you know. First, demonstrate to the patient. What I'd like you to do is, with your heel, start from your knee and go all the way down to your ankle. Similarly, the other side. With your heel, go all the way. First, show him. Next, ask him to close his eyes and do it. Can you close your eyes and do it, please? Yes. Another headache. This is it. If the person has got a cerebellar problem, the person will do all those funny things and may try to look where he is doing and all those things. So you asked him to do it once, he got the hang of it, then he should do it, both sides. So this is the Hilshin test. This is also a point-to-point test, but with a lower limb. This was a point-to-point test with a hand. This was a point-to-point test with a lower limb. We are good? Next one. Next slide, please. The gate. I can use you for the gate. Come. Would you like to walk this way or this way? Just walk normally. Go all the way up to the whiteboard and come back to me. Yeah. Thank God she can do this one. This is the catwalk, isn't it? Okay.
No, I'm not, I can do that. I'm walking normally.
Yeah. Just walk. Go all the way to a particular distance and then turn. So watch for the stance, the gait, the movement, the rhythm, the equilibrium, the hand motion, everything. It's just a standard walking, how the person turns, whether the person turns in one shot or whether the person turns in multiple blocks. Because I will be teaching all those things in Parkinson. They will have what is called R-block turn stance and all those things. They'll have magnetic gait and all those things. So her gait is fine. The next one will be tandem gait or heel-to-toe walking like you do when you're being tested for alcohol by the police, isn't it? So this is a straight line. So you have to walk in a straight line. Yes.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
She's drunk.
Okay. Please turn around and come back. Wow. One smooth turn. Yes.
Oh my God.
Okay. So blood alcohol 0/0. This is the tandem walking. Next, I can use you now. You have to walk on your heel. You can walk up and down.
My socks are shit.
Okay, just doesn't matter. Walk on your heel and then turn around and walk on your toes. This, walking on heel.
Look, we're in stilettos.
Yes. So this is heel walk and toe walk.
Penguin.
In corticospinal tract lesion also, they have difficulty in heel walking. It also tests for cerebellum. Next one, I think I'll use him. That is, you have to hop in one place, first with one leg and then the other leg. Hop in one place. Then with the other leg. And then with both the legs. Shallow.
Appreciate that.
So this tests for both proximal and distal muscles. Heel walking and toe walking tested only the distal musculature. The next one, I'll ask you to do that. And that is shallow knee bends. First with one leg, shallow knee bends. And then with the other leg, shallow knee bends.
These chains are tight.
And then both the legs.
Just doing up canal.
Shallow knee bends. This also tests for. Okay. Wonderful. Thank you. So this is.
Abel, that's Dabke. That is Dabke.
Dabke. At home you can do the additional one.
We know how to do
that. So. This also tests for the proximal and the distal muscles. Hop in one place, one leg at a time, shallow knee bends, one leg at a time, both the legs. And then finally, the next one. From a sitting position, I can use you. From a sitting position, I want you to stand up. This test for the gluteus maximus muscle, the proximal muscle. Try to see whether he takes support from somewhere or not. Because again, this is deficient in many conditions. So this is for the proximal muscle. So these are all the tests for gait. Next slide, please. The stance. We have two tests for the stance. So I'm going to use you for one and one you for the other one. So please, you have to come here so that everybody can see. This is the typical Romberg sign which we have been taught about. We'll show you exactly how it is done. First, I'll demonstrate to you. Put both the legs together. Both the legs together. Ask the patient to stretch out both the hands out, as far as possible, out. Close the eyes and remain steady for about 20 to 30 seconds. So please do that. So you'll be asking your subject to do that.
Okay.
So I'm letting everybody see that what you are being asked to do. For 20 to 30 seconds. Okay. What do we watch?
I'm gonna start
whether the person is swaying with his eyes open and whether the person is swaying with his or her eyes closed. So she's not swaying with her eyes closed. Now you can open your eyes. The person is not swaying with the eyes open either. Thank you very much. So what have we tested? We have tested if the person sways with the eyes open, obviously the person will sway with the eyes closed also. That indicates cerebellar lesion. On the other hand, if the person does not sway with the eyes open, but starts swaying when you ask the person to close his eyes, that indicates dorsal column lesion. That is Romberg sign positive, are we clear? Because the visual cue is lost. So we have done the Yeah, so that is actually a combination of both. Friedreich ataxia, there is a cerebellar problem, and there is a dorsal column problem. So you will get Actually, you can't say it's dorsal. It's purely dorsal column. They have sensory. You see, ataxia can be sensory ataxia due to dorsal column lesion. Ataxia can be cerebellar ataxia. We have learned all that. So we are tested for both, actually. The next one is the pronator drift. Watch this very carefully. I'll use you for this pronator drift. Now here, again, the patient has to keep his eyes closed. I'll demonstrate to you. With the patient's eyes, legs together, both the hands, palm up, keep it up, and eyes closed. And watch for two things. Please do that. Palm up, eyes closed, for about 20 to 30 seconds. What do we look for? First thing, whether the hand remains steady in its place or not. What is this pronator drift? If there's a corticospinal tract lesion on his left side, let's say, left corticospinal tract, his right hand will do something. Or if he's got a cerebellar lesion on the right side, his right hand will do something. What will it do? I'll show you. You can open there so that you can see. Suppose I have a lesion on my corticospinal tract on the left side or my cerebellum on the left right side. When I'm asked to do this, my hand will slowly pronate. And it may even flex at the wrist and at the elbow, and it will drift away. This is called pronator drift. So this I'm just showing you. So when you ask the person to do this, if there's a lesion, it might go. Sometimes it may go even up. So this is called pronator drift. The second part, yes.
Are they conscious that they know that they're doing that? Or?
No, they're not aware of it. That's why there's the lesion. The hand is automatically, it is unable to remain like that. The other component of this test is, the next component, yes.
During the FCM test, you could tell us to...
We will just see how you're asking the patient to do it and what you're watching for.
Okay, are you going to ask us, like, is it corticospinal tract?
I usually don't, some of the others. I don't like too many theory questions in practicals. I just watch for the procedures, whether you've done all the protocol, the steps correctly or not. That's a practical exam. The next component of this test is, after you have observed this person for a few seconds to see whether the hand is deviating or not, the next component of the test, again, continues to do the same thing. Hand is like this. The next component of the test is written in the last paragraph there, is you gently tap the hand down. Both the hands. You'll find that a normal person, it swings back again. Keep your hand eyes closed. If you do that, because the hand has got a certain amount of tone and it is remaining like that, it'll come back to its automatic position. On the other hand, if it's a cerebellar lesion, the hand will bounce. And it will do all sorts of funny things. So this is the second component of the pronator drift. So we have done the stance. What did we do? We did the Romberg test, Romberg sign, eyes closed, stretched out, and we watched for swaying, and we watched the pronator drift and the bouncing of the hand. So we have finished the cerebellar tests. So this stance gait and the cerebellar done. So we have finished with the motor system, we finished with the cerebellar. Next slide, please. You will be given during the lab. The next one, sensory system. Okay, so again we will start, and I'm going to use, this is actually the lumbar puncture needle which you're going to be using in your last lab. We are not going to do pain, but pain is done with the tip of a safety pin, so we are not going to do the pain.
Do it, Amit.
Temperature, again we won't do it, but you're supposed to do it with the test tube of hot and cold water. Which nucleus carries pain temperature?
Spinal.
Spinal nucleus.
Yes. He said it twice.
I'm still hopping mad. Okay, light touch is crude touch. That is done with a wisp of cotton. You'll be given a cotton. You'll be testing for light touch, crude touch. And fine touch is again with the tip of a pin. With the tip of a pin, but you don't press so hard so as to produce a pain. But we won't do that. But you'll be given a light touch, you'll be given a wisp of cotton, and you'll do light touch. When you do the sensation, I'm just assuming that I'm holding a piece of cotton. You have to do corresponding areas. You have to do, always go from an anesthetized area to a normal area. Suppose the patient says, I don't have any sensation on my wrist or wherever. So start from that area and keep going proximally till the person feels sensation. Compare with the opposite side. Again, the same area. One very important point here. You have to ask the patient to close his or her eyes. I'll be watching for these two things. Whether you're doing both the sides simultaneously, and whether you've asked the patient to blow, because invariably you lose points on these two points, issues. Ask the person, because otherwise the person sees, he or she will definitely say, yes, of course I'm feeling the touch. So we have to ask the patient to close their eyes. So that is how you test for, you'll be the cotton bull. Let me demonstrate the other one, the vibration and the joint position, the dorsal column sensations. This is actually 256 hertz For vibration, you're supposed to use 128, the low frequency one. This is used for hearing. I don't have the 128, so I'm using this. How do you use the tuning fork? Never touch the prongs. Always hold the stem. And many of you will do all sorts of funny things to make it vibrate. Give it a sharp tap over the heel of your hand. Can you hear the whining sound?
Yes.
Do not hit on the table, or do not hit a hard surface. All those are wrong. Because if you hit here, see, it produces two different harmonics. Did you notice? So this is not acceptable. We will watch this, whether you're doing it the right way or not. So best is to hit the heel of your hand. If you touch here now, again, the vibrations will stop. So once you've set it in vibration, can I start by testing on the dorsum of the thumb? You can do this on the dorsum of the other digits also. This is where we start from. If this is abnormal, then you can go proximally to other bony areas. Like, for example, you can do it on the olecranon process. You can do it on the acromion. You can simulate on the foot. I'm not asking you to remove your shoes. You start on the dorsum of the great toe. If it is abnormal, then you can go to the medial valleolus. Then you can go to the medial epicondyle. You can go to the iliac crest and all the rest of it. So start with the dorsum of the great toe and dorsum of the thumb. So this is for vibration. So these are the things which we'll be watching for. How you strike the tuning fork, how you set it in motion, whether you're touching this or not, and whether... One more point here. Many patients do not know the difference because patients are not as intellectuals as you, right? Patients do not know the difference between pressure and vibration. Because you're holding it here, they might interpret the pressure itself as vibration. So what do we do? When you're thinking that perhaps the patient is confusing pressure with vibration, you quietly stop it. Stop the vibration with your finger, with your hand. And then ask him, are you feeling the vibration or not? If he says, yes, I'm still feeling the vibration, then you know he's guessing. Because that means it is the pressure which is confusing as vibration. So this is another, these are small tricks of trade actually for doing this procedure. So that is the testing for vibration. So this is a dorsal column sensation. Now we come to the other one, the joint position. So can I use you now? For this, you'll have to remove your socks and you'll have to sit down.
Smell.
Where did this one come from? Okay, so here, because joint position of the great toe is a very important test. Remember in vitamin B12 deficiency, this is the first sensation to be lost. In many B12 deficiency, many dorsal column lesions you have learned, joint position is lost. And the best way to test for it is the great toe. First, again, we will do it on both the sides. Don't forget. First, you'll have to demonstrate to the patient what exactly you're doing. You have to explain. So, you want Mr. Dabaja, yes. Mr. Dabaja, what I'm going to do is, please look carefully. When you feel your great toe going up, you will say it's up. No, not now. I'm just telling you what I'm going to do. This is, when it is here, you'll say it is down. When it here, it's out. And when I do like this, you'll say it's going around. Next point, separate the great toe away from the other toes. Why? Because he should not get the feeling from the other toes and tell you what his position is. I'll be watching this. Move the great toe away from the other toes, demonstrate to him what you are going to do, and then please close your eyes, Mr. Dabaja. What is the position of your great toe? Wonderful. What is the position of your great toe? What is the position now? Going around. So this is how you do. If you let it touch the other toes, I deduct points. Because when you touch the other toes, he will use the sensation of the other toes to tell you his position, right? So I'll watch whether you have removed it from the other toes, whether you have clearly explained to the patient. And again, patient's eyes should be closed. Don't forget, you lose points on that. You forget to tell the patient to close his or her eyes. And again, do it on the other side corresponding. You forget to do that, again you lose points. So please close your eyes. Which is the position of your great toe?
Down.
Which is the position of your great toe?
Up.
What is the position now?
Around.
So this is how you test for joint position sense. Both the sides, eyes closed, after explaining to the patient. Clear? So this is the position sense. Next one. I can use you now. The next slide, please. All of you know stereognosis. Give a readily identifiable object to the person. Can you close your eyes tell me, hold this, and tell me what is this. Now, what you can do is, this is one of the videos which I did last semester, give a series of very similar, a little different items. Let's give me these and one pencil. Now, with your eyes closed, I've got a few other objects here. With your other hand, pick these objects one by one and tell me which one matches the object in your right hand. I'm testing the stereognosis by using the corpus callosum oil. That is synesthesia.
See if it's a mechanical pencil. This one.
So,
good job.
This is what we have done. I have gone one step beyond stereognosis. First, she identified this with her eyes closed, so that was stereognosis. And then I used her corpus callosum to match this with that. So we did two. We have extended the test of stereognosis. You have to give a familiar object. You should not give a strange object. So it's a coin or a key or a pencil or something which the person uses daily. And you should allow the person to move that object in his or her hand. They cannot just touch it. They should be allowed to move it in their hand, because stereognosis is a complex, it's a cortical sensation. It's a combination of touch, pressure, and conscious proprioception. So all these things together will be integrated in the cortex. Remember, primary sensory cortex and the superior parietal region and inferior parietal lobule. Next one. Number identification. Close your eyes, please. If the person has got, let's say, I'm going to do the next one again, then I'm going to do the next one. If the person has got, let's say, she has got arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, or she has got some injuries in her hand, or she cannot move her fingers, or something like that, does that mean that you will not do stereognosis? We have other methods of doing it, right? What will we do? We will do the usual old-fashioned method. We will write, I did this in the classroom. You write a familiar letter on the palm of the hand and ask the person to identify it. Again, don't forget to do it on the other side. Don't forget to tell the patient to close his eyes. I'll be watching for these things. So we did. So if you can do stereognosis, you can do graphesthesia.
So you write the same thing on both hands.
You can write another one also. You can write something which you know the person is familiar with. So I know he's a highly educated and a highly intelligent man. So he does know what is 3, and he does know what is A. So he will definitely be able to identify it. So this is graphesthesia, and you know this is a cortical sensation. The next one, two-point tactile discrimination. I don't have the object, but you'll be given a pin. So the 2 points of the pin, you have to do it, again, with the eyes closed. You have to do it on the palm of the finger. So you can touch the 2 points of the pin. And ask the person whether he or she can feel the 2 points separately or not. So this is 2-point tactile discrimination. Again, do it on the same side, opposite side, corresponding areas. Normally, the pulp of the finger is the most sensitive. They can identify 2 separate as even less than 5 millimeters. On the flexor aspect, it becomes a little less sensitive, but it is still sensitive. On the extensor aspect and on the back, it is very sensitive. They cannot identify anything closer than 3 centimeters. Finger, 5 millimeters. This is 2-point discrimination. Next slide, please. So it's all. There are 2 related tests, you'll be doing them. One is called point localization, and the other is called tactile extinction. We have told you all that, isn't it? What is point localization? You ask the person to close his eyes, you touch him on one particular place in the hand, and ask him, where did I touch you? Where did I touch you? Show me, please. You can open your eyes and show me. Okay. Similarly, do it on the other side. Close your eyes, please, Mr. Tabaja. Show me where I touched you. Now you can open your eyes and show me where I touched you. So this is point localization. And an extended version of that, which is used for the trunk and for the lower lips. Can you sit down, please, Mr. Tabaja? You have to keep saying it so that he knows that you are, you're sort of, that's how you build a rapport. What I'm going to do, I'm going to touch you in certain parts of your body. And I should have done it on purpose. It would have redeemed me. And you'll have to show me where I... Okay? Please tell me where I touched.
Open your eyes.
Okay. So this is tactile, bilateral simultaneous stimulation to test for tactile extinction. And you have already learned that when the person has got a superior parietal cortex lesion, or when a person has got corpus callosum lesion, anterior 4/5 of the corpus callosum, which by the way, again, less than 50% of the class got, right? The person has got contralateral tactile extinction. So these are the tests for sensations. So again, these are the sensory systems. We do it for all upper limb and low. The lower limb, we do precisely the same thing. I'm not doing it again. The only difference is in lower limb, you don't do stereognosis, you don't do graphesthesia. Because you can't feel a coin with your foot, can you? Neither can you feel my writing on your foot. I don't think you'll be able to do it. So we don't do stereognosis and graphesthesia for the lower limb. Otherwise, the rest of the tests, we do the same. Okay, the next one, please. So we are finished with the motor system, sensory system, cerebella. The last one remains, and that is the deep tendon reflexes. So here, can you sit down again? I'm going to use... So all of you know the Gendre 6 maneuver. Now, a few things I need to tell you before I start with the deep tendon reflexes. How to hold the knee hammer. Many of you are going to use the knee hammer like a bludgeon. Of course it does happen. People use their shoulder, they use their all sorts of muscles. The knee hammer is supposed to be with only your finger and your wrist. Finger and your wrist, watch. Finger and your wrist, not your elbow muscles, not your shoulder muscles, no. Yes, so that's the first point. So look at the picture down there. So you see how it is moving. That's why it's been designed. That's the first point. Again, there's a grading of reflexes. Zero, no, you have to know the grading. Generally speaking, two is normal. Three is brisk, four is very brisk, five is clonus. I'll tell you what is clonus. Less than two is hypo, and zero is absent. You have to know the grading of reflexes. Deep tendon reflexes. So that's about the knee hammer, how to hold the knee hammer. Again, we'll have to do the reflexes. Next slide, please. Upper limb, the three reflexes that we will be doing. I'm going to demonstrate the upper limb, I'm going to demonstrate the lower limb. The three reflexes that we'll be doing will be the biceps, the triceps, the brachioradialis. So let's start with the biceps. Before that, when do we use the pointed end, when do we use the broad end? There's some simple rules of thumb. If the tendon is narrow, use the broad end. The two examples where we use the broad end is brachioradialis and the tendocalcaneus, tendoachilles, because the tendons are narrow. If you use the narrow end, you're likely to miss it. That's why you use the broad end. Biceps is also a narrow tendon, but biceps is the only exception where you don't tap on the tendon directly. You keep your thumb on it, and we'll be watching that. Biceps, there are several ways of doing it. One is in the sitting position. Okay, the patient is sitting. Chanel, so what I would like you to do is keep your hand very relaxed on my hand. Absolutely. Ask the person to keep the full weight of the hand absolutely relaxed on your own hand. Patient should not be stiff or tense. Relaxed. Feel for the biceps tendon and you will be able to feel it very easily. You will be able to feel it in the cubital fossa. It's very easy. Once you feel the biceps tendon, give a gentle pressure on the biceps tendon. In fact, if you're right about it, you will feel the pulsations of the brachial artery right medial to that. I can feel it. So the biceps tendon, I've given a little traction. Now what I'm going to do is, because the area is very limited here, I cannot use the broad portion. I have to use the narrow portion, but I have localized it with my thumb. I'm going to tap my thumb with the pointed end of the knee hammer. Are we clear? So this is how we will do. Keep it relaxed, absolutely. Did you watch the muscle contracting? You can stand up, right? So, there. It did contract. I felt it. It did contract. There.
What's wrong with it?
It is so sensitive that I can do it with my finger. I'm tapping it with my finger.
That hurts. Sir, I bruise easily. That hurts. Okay.
Similarly, do it on the other side. You can do it. Do it on the other side. Keep your hand relaxed, Chanel. Again, feel the biceps tendon. Feel the biceps tendon. Feel the biceps tendon. Tap on your thumb. Here. There. And you will be able to feel the contraction of the biceps. This is the biceps reflex. If the patient is lying down, you can ask the patient, you can again put your hand like this and you can tap. If the patient is lying, see, it's contracting already. See? Can you see? Yeah. It's contracting.
Yeah, you can
so
see that.
So that is with the patient. So it's the lower two pictures. The lower two pictures. Patient sitting, patient lying. Next, the triceps. There are three ways of doing it. The nice method is hang the limb out to dry. This is called hanging the limb out to dry. Like you're hanging clothes, you know. So I have made her hand hang as if I'm drying it on a clothesline. So keep it relaxed, absolutely. Put the full weight of your hand on my hand. Yes, that is important. And you feel it just above the olecranon process. And you tap this area. There.
Yeah, I see.
That is the triceps reflex.
Do it again.
There is another
Can
one.
You do it again?
Keep it relaxed. Keep your full weight. Ask the patient to be absolutely relaxed and keep the full weight of his or her hand on your hand. Usually patients will be stiff. You will not get the reflex. Okay, in the exams, even if you don't get the reflex, we are not judging you on that. I'm going to watch your procedure, how you're doing it, whether you're doing it the right way. Keep the full weight of your hand on me. I should be able to feel the weight relaxed.
Oh, yeah.
That is the triceps. That is one way. The other way is if the person is lying down, you can just ask the patient to flex and you can tap there. So that is another way to do it. So patient lying, patient sitting. And the third one is the brachioradialis. Remember I said brachioradialis, the tendon is very narrow. And it is inserted on the radial styloid process. The radial styloid process, you can feel it just above the anatomical snuff box. Remember the anatomical snuff box? Where you take your salt before taking your shot. Okay, so this is your...
Look.
You're getting bruised? It's all right. All in the name of science. Because I'm going to use him for the lower limb, I'm using you for the upper limb. So feel the radial styloid process first. The brachioradialis is inserted on the radial styloid process. So you have to go approximately 1 inch above that. We have to use the broad end because it's a very narrow. If I try to do it with, I may miss. You see? So I'll use the broad end. So hold the hand in a mid-prone position because this is the position in which the brachioradialis works best. And goes lightly above that and tap. You can see the contraction of the brachioradialis there. That is how you test for brachioradialis. Again, do not forget to do it on the other side. Hold it, support in the mid-prone position, feel the radial styloid process and tap. That is the brachioradialis tendon reflex. So we have done the three reflexes, biceps, triceps, brachioradialis. Next one, please. I'm going to do the knee, ankle, and the plantar response. And I'm going to tell you what is clonus. So one way to do the knee is with the patient sitting. Give a gentle upward, keep it absolutely relaxed. Give a little stretch of the tendon. And again, this is the place where you use the broad end. Why? Because the tendocalcaneus is pretty narrow. There.
That's cool.
Similarly, on the other side, don't forget. So we'll watch whether you're using the right side, right end, and whether, again, elicitation is not the important thing. I want to see whether you're doing the procedure correctly or not. Similarly, you're grinding your... Okay. Again, keep it relaxed, absolutely. Patients will try to tense their limbs, I'm telling you. You have to repeatedly tell them, Mr. Dabaja, to keep your limb relaxed, absolutely, absolutely relaxed. You give gentle dorsiflexion to make the tendon a little taut. And there. If you do it the right way, you will get it. 100%. It's when people are not giving the proper instruction to the patient, that's why you're not able to elicit it. Suppose the person is lying down. There's another way to do it. Do we have place for you to lie down? Or there's no place for you?
Yeah. I can help myself.
Or you can just lie down. No. My God, people bring their whole household here.
That's Chanel.
If the person is lying down, there's another way to do it. Watch it. Okay.
Sorry.
Cross, can you cross your leg over the other? Keep it relaxed, absolutely. Cross one leg over the other. Keep it relaxed. Keep it relaxed. Again, give a little dorsiflexion to tauten this tendon. And tap. Keep it relaxed, absolutely.
He's so relaxed.
Look at his arm, Abed.
There.
You guys aren't letting him relax.
You can see it contracting.
So what do you look for here?
This late.
Well, you're seeing contraction of the triceps, the sure. Similarly to the other side, can you cross over? Keep it relaxed, absolutely. Give a little gentle dorsiflexion. You don't do it, I'll do it. Keep it gentle dorsiflexion and tap. Note, I did not use my shoulder or I just used my wrist. It should flow freely. There. That is. Now I'll tell you what is clonus. Clonus is grade 5 reflex. We used to, nowadays they call it clonus. Can you sit down? Suppose the person has got a very exaggerated reflex. Suppose a person has got a very exaggerated, you can hang your leg down. If the person has got a very exaggerated reflex, so exaggerated that even by touching the tendo-allogeneus, it moves very briskly, I can elicit something called clonus. And I'll show it to you how to do it. That happens when the person has got a dense corticospinal tract lesion. Very high degree of deep tendon reflex. I just rapidly dorsiflex his foot like this. You keep it relaxed. I just rapidly, even now I elicit it a little bit. I rapidly do it and it'll start flapping a few times. That is called clonus. That is, some books call it grade 5. So this was the tendo calcaneus. Now I'm going to demonstrate the next slide. Oh, it's in here. The knee jerk reflex.
So that's normal when it flaps?
No, it should not. That's exaggerated. Average normal is 2 plus. 3 plus is mild, is brisk. 4 is very brisk, and 5 is clonus.
You're the worst camera guy.
Okay. Knee jerk. Again, the procedure. Watch very carefully. You'll have to. I think I'm going to use her for this because I'll show you. This is the place where you might have to do the gender 6 maneuver. What is the gender 6 maneuver? Remember? You have to ask the person to clench. You can see it in the previous slide. There. No, the ones before that. There. The top picture. Hook the fingers, pull them apart, and ask the person to clench his teeth. That way you're increasing the gamma discharge. So we might ask you, okay, let's say this person has got a very weak reflex. How will you exaggerate it? You will ask the person to. So we'll demonstrate both in this now. Okay. So can you hook your fingers, Chanel? Like this. Pull it apart hard and clench your teeth.
Pull apart?
Your teeth.
Clench your teeth and pull your fingers apart. Yes. This is the way we have increased the gender 6 maneuver.
Oh, okay.
So, okay, I'm going to tell you where to do that. Now, can I ask you to cross your right leg over your left knee? Yes. First step. Again, tell the patient to relax. Many patients will try to keep it stiff. They are invariably stiff when a doctor is examining them. That's called the white coat syndrome. So, relax. Absolutely relax. The leg should be hanging freely. Now you ask the person to do gender 6 maneuver. Let's assume that she's got a very weak reflex and I won't increase it. Can you do that, please? Feel the the ligamentum patellae between these two bones. Which are the two bones? The patella here and the tibial tuberosity here. The patella here and the tibial tuberosity. Exactly midway between the two is the ligamentum patellae, and that's exactly where we are going to hit. Keep it relaxed, absolutely. Again. Okay, now relax. Release this. So now I've removed the gender 6 maneuver. I'm just demonstrating it to you. Relax. See the difference?
Wow.
It was there, but it was milder.
Oh, wow, yeah.
When she did the gender 6, it became exaggerated. Yes? Do the other one, see. Can you cross over the other leg, please? Keep it relaxed. Keep it absolutely relaxed. You might have to spend a few seconds to tell the patient. Relax, relax. And when you tell them, they invariably they relax. In fact, even now, when I'm saying relax, I can feel her muscles are relaxing. Patients always tend to tense up. Okay. Feel the ligamentum patellae between these two bony prominences. The patella here, tibial tuberosity here. Can all of you see? Okay. You just have to do it once, very gently, it will happen. Now please do that, gender 6 maneuver. Of course, patient does not know it's gender 6. You'll have to explain to the patient what it is. Again, feel, keep it relaxed.
Oh my God.
Yeah. You see, visibly how it differs, gender 6 maneuver does this job. So this is the one. And now I'm going to do the...
That's crazy. The
plantar response on you, the last one. And we have...
Wow.
like that. It's, yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
I don't have a sharp object, so I'm going to use my key. I'm going to use my key. So, can you go back? Exact procedure for doing the planter.
I'm sorry.
Can I remove the sauce, please?
They go inside
with
the
rapist. Okay.
You have to start from the lateral aspect of the soul. The lateral aspect of the soul. And go from the heel, go all the way up to the ball, the heads of the metatarsals, and then turn medially. So this will be the procedure. Put a hand on the lower leg. Lateral aspect of the sole, and go deliberately. So this is the plantar response, normal. Normal plantar response, all the toes with plantar flex. And the abnormal one, you know, dorsiflexion of the great toe and fanning out the other toes. Again, do it the other side. Plantar response. Can I do the last one on you? Just you, if you don't mind, just lift up your. Can you lift up this? Your. Are you feeling embarrassed? It's all right. We won't do it. The abdominal is shown there. Abdominal, you have to go from
outer to inner.
He has a six pack.
It's all right. Anybody volunteering for the abdominal reflex? You go from the lateral to the medial, along the rib cage. You go from lateral to medial.
Surge.
There's a six pack.
Circuit.
Come on.
You have a six pack.
Come on.
So
you just go from lateral to medial along the rib cage. Lateral to medial along the inguinal ligament. Ah, there. He's the man. No, just mix it up. You have to lie down. Because abdominal reflex is tested lying down. For obvious reasons, we are not going to do the crevastoid reflex and we are not going to do the anal sphincter reflex. Again, as a person to be relaxed, keep your head down, keep it relaxed. So this is the rib cage, this is the inguinal ligament, rib cage. Go from lateral. Keep it relaxed, absolutely relaxed. Go from the lateral. See, you saw the contraction? And again, go from lateral. There. There. So this is 7, 8, 9. This is 10, 11, 12. So that's abdominal reflex. And of course, the other two reflexes are cremaster and anal reflex.